All successful clinical trials are alike, but each failed clinical trial fails in its own way. In other words, the lack of one of the required conditions can make it impossible to achieve the desired result. So now imagine that you are working on a monoclonal antibody that might be potentially used in immunotherapy. Many autoimmune diseases, such as rheumatoid arthritis, show imbalance of certain receptor ligand signaling pathways, which can be critical in developing inflammation. So targeting these interactions by binding the monoclonal antibody with receptors could prevent the destructive inflammatory cascade. At the first step, the objective is to investigate the safety, tolerability in patients, and metabolism of the drug. So you start the phase one clinical trial. This is a first in human study with a single dose administered with the infusion or subcutaneous with 5 dose levels done on a relatively small group of individuals who are all healthy or with disease. As a result, you show that there are no adverse effects up to 30 milligrams per kilogram dose, so it's safe in patients with the disease. And in addition, using measurements of free drug and total soluble receptor, you can model PK and PD dynamics. So you go to your virtual laboratory, that is Monolix with applications, and develop a model. This is a target-mediated drug disposition model, which describes the concentration of the drug, soluble receptor, and membrane-bound receptor, and the complexes. In Monolix, you estimate model parameters, and with different diagnostic tools and plots, you verify that the model correctly fits this single dose phase one study. So what's next? Now is the time to use this information to guide as a guide for the design of the phase two study, which will analyze the effectiveness of a multi-dose regimen on the inhibition of receptor. It is intended to be exploratory phase, but its result will determine if a drug is sufficiently promising to justify the phase three clinical trial. And one of the possible sources of failure of this phase two is dosing regimen. So let's assume that 90% inhibition relative to baseline of membrane-bound receptor is a reliable predictor of clinical benefit. But in the phase one, we measured only soluble receptor. So the first question would be with which dose level we can observe this inhibition at 90%. And then what is the situation in the population? Does sufficient amount of individuals in this population reach the target? And if we now enroll different individuals, or if our parameters of the model have some uncertainty, can we still select a sufficiently promising dose to justify a phase three trial? So to answer this and many more questions, what you do, you go to Simulx, the advanced simulator for clinical trials and decision-making tool. In our first Simulx webinar, Geraldine showed you how to build a simulation from scratch. So how to write a model and how to define different parameters that can be used in the simulation scenario. Today, we are going to use a different option in which we are going to use directly a Monolix project. And on this base, we are going to define exploration and simulations and focus on the simulations of the best dosing regimens for the phase two clinical trial. So I have here this Monolix project, which is developed on the phase one, on the results of the phase one clinical study. The structural model, as presented in the slides, describe the free drug and total soluble receptor. I modified a model from the TMDD library and added here evolution of the free membrane-bound receptor and its complex with the drug. The statistical part of the model contains the effect of weight on the volume of distribution and the effect of disease on the baseline of the receptor. So now how to use these elements in Simulx? It is very easy. With the export in the top menu, save and export to Simulx, I will send to Simulx directly the model, parameters estimated by Monolix, and information from the dataset. So now you see that Simulx opened automatically, and in the definition tab, I have all imported elements. So first the model, structural part of the model is imported into the longitudinal section, and statistical part of the model, which in Monolix is defined in the interface, here is imported as a MLX strand coded, is imported as a MLX encoded description in the covariate and individual section. Now in the population parameter tab, I have MLX pop element, which has one set of population parameters that were estimated by Monolix. In the individual parameter tab, I have different elements, which depends on which task you run in Monolix. For instance, MLX pop indiv covariate corresponds to individual parameters that are given by typical population value plus effect of covariates, or conditional mean, MLX conditional mean corresponds to individual mean from conditional distribution. In the covariate section, the elements contain only covariates that are defined in the model in the Monolix project. So in this case, it is weight and patient. So there are two types of element. One is a table with the values from the data set for each individual. And the second one is a distribution, which allows Simulx to sample from the sample covariate values from a distribution with the same typical value and standard deviation as in the dataset. Now the treatment comes directly from the dataset used in Monolix project and has information about time and amount of for each individual of a dose. And outputs has two types. So it has a time grid for model prediction. This is MLX underscore L for drug and MLX underscore R total for total soluble receptor. So you see this is a time grid. And it has also simulated model observation with the prefix Y, which is a sum of model prediction plus residual error. Now in the simulation tab, we have everything ready to re-simulate Monolix project. However, Simulx works independently from Monolix, so the simulated data set, even if looks similar to the one used in Monolix, is not the same because we simulate different individual parameters and we have different residual error. Okay, so now this is a good starting point for our investigation of new dosing regimens or optimal dosing regimens for the phase two clinical trial. I'm going to start in the exploration tab to see which dose level assures or guarantees the 90% inhibition of the membrane-bound receptor. So first, let's define new treatment. Here, I'm interested in a multi-dose regimen, and in particular, I would like to have a dose administered each 4 weeks for 6 months. So I'm going to use a regular method with interdose interval equal to 28, which is 4 weeks, with 6 doses and amount of 1,000. I will call this dose as flat 1,000 milligram. Now this dose, this new treatment is automatically added to the exploration group, and I just remove the first one that comes from the Monolix, from the data set used in Monolix. Okay, now the outputs. In the model, we have outputs that correspond to the free drug and the total soluble receptor. However, in Simulx, you can output any variable defined in the model. So in this case, I'm interested in the membrane receptor. What is more, with the additional lines that are at the bottom of the model definition, I can add additional computations. And as I'm interested in the inhibition of the receptor relative to baseline, I'm going to add a new variable, double R, which is the ratio between the free membrane-bound receptor and the baseline. So after clicking on apply, this new line is added in the equation block. Okay, so now let's go to output, and I'm going to add to use this variable, which I select from intermediate outputs and call it RR on a regular grid with measurements each day during 6 months, so 168 days. Now I go back to exploration and I select this output here. Now click and apply. So here we have the plot for this membrane-bound receptor relative to baseline. And we see that for the starting dose, the inhibition is only about 30%. Exploration tab is really helpful to explore in real time different treatments. So here I can see what is the inhibition for higher dose. For example, for 1,100, 200, we are still below 90%, 300, and for 1,400, we are finally with the inhibition 90%. And this dose corresponds to 20 milligrams per kilogram given to a typical individual of weight 70 kilograms. So now let's see what is the effectiveness of these doses in a population. First, I'm going to define this new treatment, so this weight-based doses, for 3 different dose levels. In the treatment, I will define again with a regular method because we are still looking for a multi-dose regimen. So every 28 days with 6 doses. And here I put amount 20 and scale this amount by a cover rate. I call this treatment as 20 milligrams per kilogram. Okay, so now if I look at this treatment, I can see the scaling formula. So here we have amount of a dose that I wrote, so 20 multiplied by weight. Now I'm duplicating this treatment element for the higher dose level, so 25. And the third one with the amount 30. Okay, now I want to see the effect of this treatment in a population of disease patients. So I have to define new cover rate element. Here I'm going to use a distribution method. And for the continuous cover rates, I have a distribution. And for categorical cover rates, I select the probability of 2 different modalities that are in my cover rate. So between healthy and patients with rheumatoid arthritis. So I said that this is 0. So I don't have any healthy individuals. And for the weight, I define a population which has a typical weight 70 with 20% of standard deviation. And denote this cover rate as cover rate RA. Now, finally, the outputs. I have already my output for the receptor relative to baseline, but I would also like to look at the concentration of the drug. So I will select here L on the same grid, so measurements each day during 6 months. And another output that I'm going to add is the inhibition relative to baseline at trough. So to do this, I'm going to use a manual method in which I write just one time point, which corresponds to the end of the treatment. And here I need to select the intermediate output, which is my RR variable, and denote it as error at trough. Okay, so now everything is ready. All simulation elements are defined, and I can go to the simulation tab. So here we want to compare these two different dose levels. So I define first three different groups, and I'm going to use a treatment as group specific. So move it to the group part. I select 20 milligrams per kilogram for the first group, 25 for the second, and 30 milligrams per kilogram for the third group. The size, the group size corresponds here to the number of individuals in the data set used for Monolix project. For the simulation of the phase two, I will use higher number, 100. I will select the new output for drug, for the receptor, and the value at trough. And here select my new cover rate, so the diseased population. In addition, with this option here, same individuals among groups, each group, as the name suggests, will have the same individuals. So the differences that I will observe are only due to the treatment, not to the variability between individuals. Now everything is ready and we can run the simulation. We have results and plot automatically generated. For the individual input, I have the same features as in Monolix. So for example, to the plots, I can add mean and standard deviation. I can modify binning criteria or set log scale and same limits for the axis. But let's look on the receptor for the output distribution. To compare it better, I'm going to put them in one line, and with visual cues, I will add the line, horizontal line equal to 0.1, which is exactly the threshold of 90% inhibition that we are looking for. So with this qualitative analysis, looking just at plots, we already see the advantage of this highest dose that we are considering. And now how to quantify these results. So this we can do with outcomes and endpoints task. So outcomes and endpoints allows Simulx for post-processing of the outputs. In particular, outcomes define or calculate measure of interest for each individual, while endpoints summarize them over all individuals. First, we are interested in the efficacy target, how many individuals actually reach this 90% inhibition at trough. To calculate it, I first define a new outcome. First, I need to select the output, which I'm going to post-process. So this is going to be RR at trough. For the output processing, actually, we have three options, but in this case, it doesn't matter because we have just one value. But I'm going to apply the threshold, which is less or equal to 0.1, which corresponds exactly to this 90% inhibition. Okay, now I click OK. And this outcome is automatically added to the endpoint. It is, of course, possible to combine several outcomes in one endpoint. For example, if you want to satisfy at the same time safety and efficacy criteria.
Now this outcome is not a value, but it's a response, yes or no, if each individual reaches the target or not. So the endpoint which will summarize these outcomes over the whole population will give us the percentage of individuals who satisfy the condition. I can also compare the maximal concentration for each dosing regimen, so for each dose level. And to do this, I'm going to define new outcome and now use the drug concentration and as a post-processing maximum value per ID. Now this outcome is a continuous value. So to summarize it over the population, I can select geometric mean, arithmetic mean, or median. Now to compute outcomes and endpoints, I do not have to rerun the simulation because in Simulx, these two tasks are separated with two separate run buttons. So I just click on outcome and endpoints. Okay, now in the section of results for endpoints, I have my values for the two of them, percentage of individuals in the efficacy target for three different groups, 58 for the first group, which is relatively small, and for the third group, so for the highest dose, it is more than 90%. And then for the endpoint two, so for the Cmax, I have median and percentiles for each group. Let's look on plots. I have now additional two plots, which is outcome distribution. In case of the percentage in the target, I can have a stacked plot in this form, which shows me directly how the percentage of individuals in the target change with the dose. And for the Cmax, I can look at in the form of histograms or in the display in the right panel, you can select a box plot and with the axis, same limits to see how the Cmax changes with the dosing regimen. This was one simulation of one population to describe the spread of the endpoint due to the variability between individuals. Instead of one simulation, I'm going to use replicates. And here, for example, I'm going to select 100 replicates. And now without using the same individuals among groups, each group is going to be simulated 100 times. I have already here a project that I run with the results. I have the values of the endpoint for each replicate, and they are also in the form of a summary with median and lower and upper interquartile value. And this is also presented in plot as an endpoint distribution, where we can very easily see that this variability between individuals brings some uncertainty to the endpoint value. Okay, let's see a little more in detail how these replicates work. I will show you this on the slide. So far in all simulations for parameter, I used MLX pop element, which contains one set of population parameters that come from that were estimated by Monolix. And now when you are simulating replicates, each replicate have the same population parameters, and then they are used to simulate individual parameters. But this is not the only option, because I could also use for each replicate different set of population parameters. In other words, I could use different population for each replicate, and then for this population simulate individual parameters. And what is the rationale behind this? For instance, Monolix not only estimated population parameters, but also their uncertainty with the standard error task. And this uncertainty can impact the uncertainty of my endpoint. One option is to define population parameters from a as a distribution. So let me show you it directly in Simulx. In the definition of population parameters, when I define new element, instead of a manual method, I select distribution, and here I select type of a distribution, typical value, and standard deviation. In this case, when you now simulate replicates, Simulx will sample for each replicate a different set of population parameters using this information. Now, the second option is to give to Simulx directly an external table, which already has several sets of population parameters. Simulx for each replicate will use one of these sets of population parameters in the order of appearance in the table. Of course, you can define this table by hand, but it is not very convenient. And for this, we have an R package called RSpeak Simulx that produces different sets of population parameters that can be directly loaded to Simulx. Package has two functionalities. First of all, it has these complementary functions to Simulx GUI, such as simpop MLX, that generate set of population parameters using covariance matrix of estimates and produce a file that can be directly used without any changes in the Simulx. Another function is writeData, which writes simulation outputs to a Monolix suite compatible format. And also there is a percentile MLX function, which allows to plot prediction intervals with several groups on the one chart. Another function of this package is to assure to guarantee retrocompatibility of existing MLXR scripts, because it has Simulx function, which works exactly as in MLXR. So let's back to our case study. First, let me show you a small example of this script, how to generate population parameters. In R, I first have to load library RS Simulx. Then here I define a project file. So this is a project file that we already seen, which is here built on the phase one clinical trial. And now with the simpop MLX function, I specify that I want to simulate 100 sets of population parameters using this project, so the covariance matrix that comes from the Monolix project. And this is the output file name, so the name of the file in which we are going to write these population parameters. Now let's look on this file. So you can see that in the first row, we have name of all parameters. And then for each line, I have 100 sets of these parameters. So now in the Simulx project, I can use this external table when I define new population parameters and define it as external. So I select the project file. And I select this file that was generated by Simpop MLX. Okay, I click OK. Now, if I look at it, it has different set of parameters for 100 replicates. Okay, so now when I'm going to simulate replicates, each replicate will have this different set of population parameters so that I can assess what is the uncertainty of my endpoint due to the uncertainty of the population parameters. So I'm not going to run this simulation, but I have already opened with the results. And now here for the parameters, instead of MLX pop, I use this new element, so pop simpop MLX. Now in the results, if I look on plots, for the endpoint distribution, we see that there is some uncertainty due to the uncertainty of the population parameters. However, for the highest dose, we are still around 90% of the population in the target. And unfortunately, for the lowest dose, we are close to the 50%, which might be not sufficient to give significantly promising results to justify phase 3 clinical trial. Okay, so with these simulations, we showed that a dosing of 30 milligrams per kilogram administered once every 4 weeks guarantees that at least 90% of individuals are in the efficacy target, even if we take into account the variability between individuals and uncertainty of the population parameters. The analysis was very fast because first we used a Monolix project with the model, with parameters estimated by Monolix and information from the data. That was a good starting point for the definition of our simulation scenario. And we used Simulx features such as exploration of dosing regimens, group comparison of different treatment arms, outcomes and endpoints to define efficacy targets and calculation of the percentage of population in the target, and to replicate to study the uncertainty. With these features, we found which dose is the most successful and which dose levels can be a cause of a failure of a clinical trial. And this brings your phase 2 clinical trial closer to success. More information about importing a project from Monolix to Simulx, you can find on our website, where also you can learn more about definition of outcomes and endpoints and about the R package R speaks to Simulx. Okay, thank you for listening.